Hello students, in this video lecture we are going to study the speed control of three phase induction motor. In our last lecture we have studied the motor speed is given by n equal to ns into bracket 1 minus s where ns is the synchronous speed given by 120 f upon p where f is the supply frequency, p is the number of poles of induction motor and s is the slip of induction motor. Now here when the slip is very small at light load, the speed is high. You know, if the slip increases, speed decreases. That means motor speed can be controlled by changing the synchronous speed or by varying the slip. Now let us consider by changing the number of poles. Now ns equal to 120 f upon p and therefore the speed is inversely proportional to the number of poles. Say at a standard frequency 50 hertz and the number of poles are always even number, so here p and here it is ns. When p equal to 2, the synchronous speed is 3000. When it is 4, it is 1500. When it is 6, the synchronous speed is 1000. For the 8 poles it is 750. For the 10 poles it is 600 rpm. Now here by changing the number of poles, by increasing the number of poles, the speed decreases, but decreasing speed is in a large steps. Say 3000 to 1500, then 1500 to 1000, 1000 to 750, like this, and therefore the change in speed is large in the steps and hence not preferred. Now let us see by changing the supply voltage. Now about the changing the supply voltage, when the applied voltage is say 50% for the induction motor, the motor achieves the speed about 80 to 90%. Now for remaining, to vary the remaining speed, to achieve the remaining 10 to 20% speed, we have to increase the voltage from 50% to 100%. Therefore, for small change in speed, need a large change in voltage. And the second factor is the torque is directly proportional to supply voltage phi square. Therefore, to decrease the speed below rated value, we have to decrease the voltage. Now when the say voltage is 50%, we will get the torque 25% only, and therefore there is a large decrease in torque when the speed decreases, when the voltage decreases. Therefore this method is also not good. And let us now consider the another method by changing the supply frequency. See, by simply decreasing the frequency and keeping the voltage constant, ratio phi by f will increase. And we know that the maximum flux density is directly proportional to phi by f for the induction motor. And as phi by f increases, bm increases, that is the phi increases in the air gap. But we have to keep the flux in the air gap constant. The reason is the bm increases means flux increases means bm increases. And as bm increases, we know that the hysteresis loss is directly proportional to bm raised to power 1.6. and eddy current loss is directly proportional to bm square. Therefore, as the flux density is large, the core losses are large and that overheat the rotor, and therefore we have to keep the v by f ratio constant. Now in order to keep the ratio v by f constant, we have to decrease the supply voltage also. Therefore, or hence, method is popularly known as v by f control method. And it can be obtained as follows. So the here it is, the AC input with constant voltage and constant frequency is fed to the converter circuit which rectifies AC into DC. Now from the DC, it is an inverter circuit which converts the DC into variable AC supply, which is a variable voltage and variable frequency and which is fed to the induction motor. So during normal operation, say the voltage is 400 and frequency is the 50 hertz. Therefore, phi by f ratio is 8, and we have to maintain this ratio 8 by decreasing the frequency. Let us decrease the frequency by 2. Say it is a 50 to 48, then corresponding voltage will be 384. Say decrease to 46, corresponding voltage will be 368, so that the ratio will remain same. So corresponding this voltage v dash is nothing but 8 multiplied by f dash. In this way, we can control the speed below rated value. Now let us turn to the stator for three phase induction motor. Now why the stators are required for the induction motor? What is the need of stator to limit the heavy starting current to a safe value? Now at any instant, the rotor current I2 is given by I2 equal to E2 upon square root of R2 upon S bracket square plus X2 square, that is equal to E2 upon Z. Now at the time of starting, slip S equal to 1, and therefore this R2 upon S becomes minimum, and therefore the impedance becomes minimum. Now we know that we have already studied in the principle of operation of the induction motor, the rotor induced EMF at the time of starting is directly proportional to the relative speed between the stationary rotor and synchronously rotating stator flux. And at the time of starting, the rotor speed is zero, and therefore the rotor induced EMF is directly proportional to the NS, which is very large, and therefore rotor EMF for E2 is very large at the time of starting, and the ZR is minimum, and therefore the current at the time of starting is very high. This large current, rotor current I2, get reflected into the stator side, that is I1 equal to I0 plus I2 dash, where I2 dash equal to KI2. Thus, during starting of the motor, draws very high starting current, generally 5 to 7 times the full load current, and hence to limit this heavy current, heavy starting current, to a safe value, stator is required. Generally, starting current equal to 5 to 7 times the full load current. Now the question is, why to limit heavy starting current? This is the question. Now what happens, because of high starting current, it produces the large mechanical thrust on the rotating parts of the motor, which may damage the rotor and shaft. Another point is, for large capacity of motor, the current at the time of starting is still higher, because the large motors have less equivalent impedance, and therefore it produces the large voltage drop in the lines, that is it increases the voltage regulations, and that's why, which affects the operation of other motors or equipment connected on the same line. Another factor is, for a large motor, the rotor moment of inertia is very large, and therefore such a motor cannot accelerate fastly, that is it takes a longer time to accelerate, which may damage the winding insulation due to high temperature rise. Now what are the types of stator used for the induction motor? Now let us see, on the stator side, the stator resistance stator, then the DOL stator, that is known as directly on line starter, then third one is star delta starter, and fourth one is autotransformer starter. And rotor side, rotor resistance starter used for the slipping motor only. Now how to limit the starting current? Now there are two basic methods, by adding the external resistance in the stator circuit, and this can be obtained for the stator resistance starter and rotor resistance starter used for the slipping motor. Now by reducing the applied voltage, we can reduce the starting current, and that this principle is used for the star delta starter and autotransformer starter. Now one more factor is the dual starter. Here neither resistance is added nor voltage is reduced, but this kind of starter is used for the small motors up to 5 HP. Now let us see the stator resistance starter. Now here in the stator resistance starter, the resistance is directly connected in series with the lines connected to the motor. This increases the effective resistance of the stator, and hence the starting current reduces. This resistance gradually cut off. Now see here, these three resistances are connected in the line of the three-phase induction motor. Here at this point, it is the start point where whole resistance is in the circuit. However, if you gradually cut off the resistance, and when it reaches to this point, it is a run. So motor get directly connected to the supply, means full voltage is applied to the motor once the motor catches the speed. But this method is not generally used because of large power wastage in the resistance. Now the another method is a rotor resistance starter for the slip ring motor. Now here for the slip ring motor, already we have studied the starter, the stator may be either star connected or delta connected. However, rotor is always star connected. The three terminals of the windings are star together, and remaining three terminals are connected to the slip rings, which are rested on the shaft, and the brushes are resting on them. Now for this, let us use the rotor resistance starter like this. It is a Y-shape, this is the handle, and this one is the start point, and this is the running point. That means at the time of starting, this much resistance is in the circuit, that connected directly in series with this phase. Similarly, this resistance is connected in another phase, this resistance is connected, and when this rotates in an anti-clockwise direction, the resistance gets gradually cut off cut off, and at this when the resistance is completely cut off, motor the